Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Sukriti Rawal, MDS third year PG from Department of Periodontology, Manav Rachna Dental College. My topic for today's presentation is forensics and periodontium. These are the contents. Okay, coming to the introduction, forensic dentistry is a challenging and fascinating branch of forensic science that involves the application of dental sciences in the identification individual through the comparison of ante and post-mortem records. The establishment of forensic odontology as a unique discipline has been attributed to Dr. Oscar Amida, who is the father of forensic odontology, who identified the victims of a fire accident in Paris in France in 1898. So the recent terrorist attacks and natural disasters in which there have been multiple fatalities has reinforced the need of trained, experienced forensic odontologists who have undergone training in mock disasters in order to coordinate the response to such events properly. So periodontics is a science which deals with diseases of periodontium. The study of periodontal structures post-mortem can help in the identification of time of death, sex of the deceased. So here is an example where forensic odontology has played an important role. In this, the highly traumatic the fire accidents and as well as the road created. For example, in this case, as you can see, where the entire soft tissue is decomposed, but still the denture is remaining. And in this, the road accident case, where there is mandibular fracture seen, but still this the teeth are intact and the soft tissues are also intact. So we can identify the deceased from these evidences. And this is the fire case from which the dental extracts can be taken and the deceased can be identified. Materials and methods. So PubMed search was done and last 10 years articles were taken. With the keywords forensic dentistry and DNA analysis, and this research was done and the presentation was prepared. So interrelationship of periodontics with forensics. These are the examples from which we can actually correlate periodontics with forensics. For example, gingival morphology and pathology, the recession, the gingival recession, for example, we can identify the age of the patient. Like recession is mostly seen in the patients with periodontitis, and periodontitis is most commonly seen in the middle-aged patients. So if there is more recession, so we can identify the patient as a middle-aged patient. And also the plaque and calculus deposits. Calculus deposits are generally more in males compared to the females. And similarly, periodontal ligament morphology and pathology, the thickness and widening and the periodontal abscess, these are also mostly evident in the middle-aged patient or the older-aged patients. So the status of alveolar bone, similarly, the bone loss. Bone loss is another symptom or let's say symptom of periodontal diseases. So it is also in older patients rather than in the younger patients. And then cosmetic surgeries. So we can also identify a patient depending on the cosmetic surgeries he has already, periodontal cosmetic surgery he has undergone before his death. For example, crown lengthening procedure or hemisection. So age estimation can also be done with the gingival recession, as I have told earlier. Then the estimation of gingival epithelium, cell death occurs by apoptosis. Liberation of tissue fluids causes cell autolysis, summing up to the cause of decomposition of the corpse. So histological examination of gingival tissues procured the postmortem and antemortem samples at different time intervals revealed that decomposition process is initiated within 10 hours after the death, and other cellular changes occur subsequently. So this is how we extract the gingival tissue. At gingiva, this is the attached gingiva, and we take a interdental brush and we scrape it off to take the cells. And then these cells are identified by PCR method, and we can estimate the age or the sex of the patient by determining the sex determining region by the SRY gene amplification. Similarly, immunohistochemistry can be done to identify the distribution and expression of hypoxia inducible factor, which is also found in gingival tissues, in order to establish a correlation between protein expression and the postmortem interval. So we can say that HIF1 degrades when there is the long postmortem interval. So we can do this by using light microscopy cells as well. And then the rugoscopy. Rugoscopy is another method for the identification. Ruge are also known as plica palatine. They are the asymmetrical connective tissue located on the anterior third of the palatal region behind the incisive papilla. This is the incisive papilla, and here the ruge are located. So according to the number of ruge, we can identify the age of the patient. We can click the pictures and we can identify whether the patient is a younger patient or older patient as ruge decreases with age. Then after death, gingival connective tissue undergoes several morphological changes involving both cellular components and extracellular matrix. So particularly collagen type 1 is present more in the gingival connective tissue, that is 90% of the total human collagen. And with time, the type 1 collagen degrades. So as the postmortem interval exceeds, the type 1 collagen degrades. So postmortem intervals depending on the tissue retrieval. So there are three types of postmortem intervals. First is the short postmortem interval, where the tissues are obtained within 3 days after death. And then the second is the mid postmortem interval, where the tissues are obtained 4 to 6 days after the death. And long postmortem interval, tissues obtained within 7 to 9 days after the death. So here is a study given by M.C. Mizotti in 2019. He did a study combining morphological and immunohistochemical analysis, where he extracted the cellular components, that is the connective tissue, extracellular matrix of gingival tissue, and collected at different postmortem interval. And then he did his analysis using the transmission electron microscopy with combination with the immunohistochemistry detection. And he detected collagen type 1 and collagen type 3. So he basically used 10 cadavers and divided them into 3 intervals. That is the short postmortem interval, then mid postmortem and long postmortem interval. And he took the control as well. So the result showed that there was gradual degradation of the extracellular matrix in the connective tissue in relation to different time of death. So this is the pictorial description. This is the oral epithelium. The green part is the connective tissue and the red part is the oral epithelium. So as you can see in the short postmortem interval, the colors are still there. But as the postmortem interval, it shows the degradation of the tissue, and this is the control. So similarly in connective tissue, the collagen type 1 was seen. So in the short, as you can see, there is the degradation of collagen type 1 from short postmortem interval to the long postmortem interval, and this is the control. Also, cementum can be a very good marker for the age estimation of the deceased, as the cementum is a connective tissue and a part of periodontium that surrounds the tooth and is deposited throughout the life. So there are incremental lines on the cementum. You can see here, there are incremental lines. These are the incremental lines. And with each incremental line is deposited every year. So of the patient by using this formula, number of incremental lines is equal to the total width of the cementum from the dentino-cementum junction to the width of the cementum. So number of incremental lines can be estimated, and with the number of incremental lines, we can estimate the age of the patient or the deceased. So this phenomenon is basically this test is known as dental cementum incremental analysis. also the season can be estimated. Because Weddell in 2007, he did a study and he showed that opaque bands were seen in the early October, and the incremental lines in the in April showed the translucent bands. So we can by this we can also estimate the season of the Dickies, the death of the Dickies. So gingival margin, the marginal tissues. Recession of periodontium has been used as one of the several indicators of age in methods of age estimation. Gingival tissue change. A study given by Guru Raj in 2004, he studied that the postmortem changes in gingival tissues. Gingival section from the dead individual showed vacuolation of the nuclei in the spinous layer of the epithelium. And also Langerhans cells can be seen. The count of Langerhans cells and the frequency of oral mucosal Langerhans cells varies inversely with the degree of keratinization. Then alveolar bone in age. The measurement of alveolar bone level.
Voice is not clear.
Hello, ma'am. So the bone, according to the bone loss and the alveolar resorption also, we can estimate the age of, and then also the melanin pigment, the pigmentation, basically the stains on the teeth. So the more stains are seen in the patient, the male patient, rather than in a female patient. So we can identify the patient according to the stains present on the teeth. So coming to the conclusion, forensic odontologist identifies a person by determining the sex, age, and using the gingival tissue, bone, all the forms of dental treatment and dental records and preserves. So the periodontists also actively participate in this research, as you have seen, taken by the gingival tissues and the periodontium. These are the Thank you.